of the four core factions in Netrunner, Wayland is the faction I've been playing with the least, most easily, because it is the faction I feel least comfortable with playing. It just isn't in my playstyle to tag and bag runners and accumulate bad publicity that will only work against me in the long run. Alright, so let's jump into the game. I'm playing against a silhouette, and it turns out it's a big rig silhouette because her first click involves installing Magnum Opus and clicking 3 times. This tells me that she's running big rig, so I hope I don't have to worry about events. Hence, I did a very early play of scoring the geothermal fracking, hoping beyond hope that she doesn't run any inside jobs. I mean, most criminals will run inside job, but I am taking a risk here because I saw the Magnum Opus play, and anyway, I'm trying to score a geothermal fracking, not an Atlas. It would be much more painful to get an Atlas stolen from me, because an over-advanced Atlas is much more important than a geothermal fracking. But in any case, he does not use any inside job, so that's great. And I managed to score the geothermal fracking, which is very important, because if he decides to chain siphons, at least I will have geothermal fracking to back my economy up. I show him the bad news over R&D and HQ. An ice wall on each makes it very hard to penetrate through. But of course, all he needs to do is to pull out his corroder and he'll get through any day. So that's what I'm worried about. I'll definitely need to find a greater variety of ice to place over my centrals. He also gets an alias out, which means no more Grim or Archer's shenanigans. Alright, so now that there's a bit of downtime, let me explain my deck a bit. This is not actually my deck. This is a deck that I completely net decked off the internet. I don't usually do this. What I usually do is to read forum threads and tournament winning decklists and come up with my own ideas or variations of these ideas. That is how I form my tournament winning gate deck, for example. Okay, I did win tournaments, but I performed pretty well in them. So yeah, thanks to the Gate Knight forum thread in Board Game Geek, I managed to do very well with the Gate Knight deck that I constructed as a variant of what I saw on the internet. But this is completely different. This is a deck that I completely copied card for card from the tournament winning deck list. Alright, so back to the game. He legworks through my HQ, taking advantage of the fact that he just installed the breach, and unluckily for me, that means that both my hostile takeovers are gone. That is such a pity, because I definitely need the hostile takeovers for money and for Archer fodder. So that was a very painful loss, but now I managed to draw up with Anonymous Tip and find both of my Scorched Earths. So if he plays carelessly from now on, he's going to regret it heavily. Yes, legworking on click 4 is one of the most dangerous things you can do as a runner. And right there, if I had a snare and a Scorched Earth in hand, he wouldn't be living to see the next turn. But thankfully for him, I did not have any of those cards, so he was fine for that turn. But my drawing out of cards did not net me any code gates, which is what I desperately needed to see, because now my central servers are wide open since his breach is out. And because I have the bad publicity working against me, he is getting in for very cheap. And he has a Magnum Opus out anyway, so I know I cannot win him through taxing his runs. All I can do is to keep him out, which is very difficult to do. And I still don't see any code gates, so this is looking horrible for me. Let's see. Yes. Looking at his rig, I can immediately tell what kind of deck he's running. He's running all the central breakers, and he's running Doppelganger. So this means that he's playing the Quest Completed Notoriety variant, where he attempts to get through all the central servers within the same turn in 2 or 3 clicks and use the last few clicks to score notoriety or use quest completed to attack my remotes. This is why he'll never need any remote breakers. This is why I attempted to score the Atlas this very turn, because I knew that once the passport hits the table, my game is over. There's no way I'm able to win, because he can lock down all 3 of my centrals and snipe off anything in my remote while at it. So installing the Atlas means that he is forced to run through all three central servers, which he cannot because he lacks the credits to do so. I took advantage of this scoring window because he left himself on one credit on the previous turn, which is a misplay in my opinion, because as long as he keeps himself afloat on credits, he should be feeling pretty good about himself. But because he failed to do so, I managed to get another two more agenda points. So that leaves me with three more agenda points to score before he gets his passport out, which is a pretty tall order. I hope to draw an enigma and some sort of agenda in the upcoming turn. Alright, so back to my net decking. I have played with Wayland Tech and Back before, but not the Super Modernism variant, which involves anonymous tips and snares. I never really was a fan of that, but seeing that I failed with playing Wayland so much quite some time ago, I decided to try it again, if only to just play Wayland so that I know I can get a feel of the tempo that a Grundle or Wayland player strikes to achieve, so that I can run against Wayland better. Yes. This deck was retrieved from steamhack.com. They have published a list of tournament winning deck lists. There were three Grundle winners, regional winners, or in Honor and Profit, that used the Grundle ID. Of these three, all of them used the Super Modernism variant with three snares included as influence and two anonymous tips. So I look to copy those decks exactly, card for card, and I pretty much saw that the only difference between the decks were the choice of the 5-3 agenda and the ice composition. Pretty much everything else was the same. You know, all decks contain at least two subliminal messagings, three scorched earths, and the seesaws, three hedge funds, three restructures. There were some things about those decks that were different from my original Grundle deck, which I played a long time ago. Notably, there were no Jackson Howards at all, even for the power shutdown. There were no Beanstalk royalties because those provide way too little benefit for the click investment. And the ice composition contained three archers. I was never a fan of three archers because my opinion is that after the first archer, the rest are pretty useless because you don't really want to be using, you don't want to rest more than one archer in a single game. But because everyone seems to be running three archer, I suppose there must be some wisdom to that. So I decided to try it out for myself. This is one of the reasons I'm saying that I'm net decking instead of playing my own variant. Given the choice, I would run two archers instead. I mean, look at my hand right now. I'm flooded with archers, which are completely useless. I don't need archers this game because Alias completely chews up archers. I can't tax him this game because he has too much bad pup and he's running Magnum Opus, and I saw him discard Emergency Shutdown during one of his discards, and the last thing I want to do is to lose an archer to Emergency Shutdown. So, yeah. I'm not that big a fan of Archer since he has so many counters and requires you to sack a hostile takeover, which is pretty expensive. Anyway, but that's not for me to choose. If I want to learn more about Wayland and be good at it, I should strive to copy what others have had success with, and hence I'm running their decks, hoping to see if I can make the big plays myself. Alright, so back to the game. Sorry for this lengthy diversion. I felt secure about scoring the geothermal fracking the remote because I have just sniped off his passport with a power shutdown. This is one of the powerful parts about including power shutdown. It is good against SMCs, it's good against fairies, but in this particular matchup, it's fantastic against passports because once I snap off the decoder, I'm able to score freely. and I have a chimera protecting archives, so he's not going to be able to get through to quest complete my geothermal fracking. So I'm feeling pretty good about this, and this would win me the game because I'm on 5 agenda points. He does snipe an Atlas from R&D, and here's the nasty surprise, he does run inside job. Duh, of course, you are playing quest completed silhouette. Of course, you will run inside job to get past any ice that you are worried about. So because of that, I bled 4 agenda points this turn. Had I not installed the geothermal fracking, I don't think he would have ran R&D anyway. So, ouch, that was a very painful turn. Because I completely forgot about quest completed. Huge mistake. Sorry, not quest completed, inside job. That is a very, very nasty card. But I definitely should be better than that. This is definitely an expected move, and I was just overcome by stupidity that turn. In a haste to close out the game before he could get back on his footing, I completely neglected the possibility of him running inside job. So, a very harsh learning lesson as he's about to win the game, being on match point. Alright, so now that I have a secure archives, because I have double iced it up, and he still doesn't have his passport out, I decided to go for the win once more, with the Atlas in the remote server. I finally joined to my first code gate of the game, the Enigma. Well, now it's too late and I don't need it anyway. I decided to toss the false lead into archives because I was worried he would attempt to make a run on HQ, and if he gets the 1 in 5 false lead off, he would win the game. So I cannot let him have that. He installed a passport from his hand because any good runner would run redundant breakers in case of program crashing. So that's it. It's game over for me. I calculated that he has 19 credits, which is way too much for me to tax him off with, so I decided to just let it go, not rest any ice, and he can have the game, because there was no way I was going to stop him from running all 3 central servers this turn. So I was completely banking on him not being able to get through archives, but this game, his installation of passport cost me the game. He did access the snare, but all that did was give him a tag and discard his 3 notorieties. Oh, wait. Wait a minute. He just lost his game-winning condition. Apparently, his plan was to install access all 3 of my centrals, and in so doing, score a notoriety to close out the game. But he can't do that when all his notorieties are now in his heap. So the snares are really, really paying off for me right now. Not just for the giving the tag, but the 3 net damage completely saved my behind this game. Wow. Can you believe it? Let's not even talk about the chances of that snare landing. The chances of him taking all 3 net damage on 3 notorieties is 1 in 4. Not to mention the chance of him accessing the snare from my hand, which is pretty low to begin with, even though I have 2 copies in hand. He then attempts a Hail Mary run on R&D because, well, he needs the last agenda and he could top deck it, but he doesn't. So, of course, the next logical move for him is to run R&D, run HQ again, in the hopes that I have an agenda in there. But all I have in HQ is yet another snare waiting right there to flatline him, to humiliate him. Yes, it's a very humiliating loss, but that being said, I definitely got very lucky this game. I definitely did deserve to win, especially after that stupid inside job play, which I completely should have anticipated and worked around instead of rushing to close out the game in such a way that was very risky. So yes, it's mostly my poor play that is the reason why I don't play Wayland very well. It does take quite a bit of skill to pilot Wayland, much more so than NBN in my opinion. And whether I decide to master it or not is something to think about down the road. But for now, I'm just gaining experience so that I can gauge the tempo of Wayland and especially Grindel in particular, because Grindel is very scary when it comes to threatening flatlines. So that's all I have. Thanks for watching, and have a pleasant day.